Cool. So I'm going to tell you about what we really wanted to build. And before I start the video that kind of tells you the product requirement, I'm going to ask you a few questions so that, you know, people are connected to me as well. How many of you here watch cricket and watch cricket on Hotstar? Yeah, I can see some hands. How many of you do really watch it, the entire match at full go? I see lesser number of hands, right? A few hands here. So that is what we realized, that cricket in general, when you watch an entire match, has really like a lot of dull moments in between, and you really get disconnected from it, and you know, you go, you know, check your WhatsApp or check your social media, or you know, go do something else, you know, kind of disconnect from that game or the video and go do something else. And there are a lot of ad breaks in between as well, right? So when there are ad breaks, you can't really just be glued to the screen, so you take your take your focus away. So that is what we realized, that you know, why can't we tackle those dull moments and make it interesting so that the user can put his focus solely on the platform. And that kind of is really great for Hotstar, right? Because if a user goes frequently out of the platform, it is not really good for the platform. But if there is enough amount of stuff that the user can focus on just apart from the match itself in the first place, it'll be really good for us. And that is what we wanted to target, right? So, and I also want to ask you another question. So I personally really like watching matches, be it any sport, with my friends, or, you know, let's say at a sport bar, or let's say in a stadium. So there is really something of a difference, right? When I'm watching a match on Hotstar versus when I'm watching a match on, let's say, in a stadium or in a sports bar, there is something that differs, right? So something that differs is what we wanted to tackle at. Why can't we bring a stadium or a sports bar like experience to Hotstar? And that is where we came up with, is the mic off? Is it on? Okay, cool. So what we wanted to build was a Hotstar sports bar, and that is how we came up with this. So I'm going to play the video, and while the video plays, so what we thought about is, can I talk to my friends in Hotstar? Can I post a selfie in Hotstar? Can I shout out for the team that I really like? Can I say that Dhoni is the best captain or the coolest captain? Can I say Kohli is going to make a century, right? We thought, why can't we do all of these things on Hotstar and, you know, bring that experience and make it wholesome so that you can also watch the match and you can also experience and enjoy that experience, like enjoy that match amongst your friends, right? Even if you're sitting, let's say, at your home and, you know, your friend is somewhere else as well. So this is what we came up with. This is the experience that we wanted to power, right? For us to be able to power this experience, what we decided was that we needed a bunch of things. Yes. So what we realized was, to be able to power that product experience, there is something core that we wanted, which is for us to be able to transmit messages in real time to our client applications, right? And I'll give you some context about it. So for example, if I type that Dhoni is the coolest captain, right? As a user, as a Hotstar user, that goes to Hotstar. Hotstar wants to, you know, vet that comment, whether it is profane or not. If the algorithm say that, you know, the comment is not profane, we want to deliver this message to, let's say, 20 million users in real time. So that is really the problem at scale. I would not go and talk about how the other system worked, but what I would go and talk about is, if I have a message that needs to be transmitted to the client, how can I transmit it in real time with a performance system? So that was really the problem statement that we wanted to power. If you could have that communication layer set up, you know, building the entire logical infrastructure or business logic would not be that difficult, right? So that is what we really wanted to tackle, and that is the problem statement that we're going to talk about today. We wanted to build a messaging infra which should have a real-time delivery. We cannot afford latency in the system. We wanted to be able to support 50 million concurrent connections at one go. So during the last World Cup, India played a semi-final match, and we saw peak concurrency reach 25.3 million concurrent users. So 25.3 million concurrent users in the world were watching the match on Hotstar, right? So what we want is, if I want to send a message, it should at least be able to go to 25 million users in real time, concurrently. And we wanted to still support for future, which is 50 million concurrency. Obviously, it has to be push-based, because the client polling for something will not be as efficient and not real time. It will obviously add latencies. So we went with push-based. We wanted to be production ready before IPL, and that. So Hotstar has really stringent standards for us to be production ready. So we thought that if IPL is going to start in March, we need to be production ready by January, and we should be testing in production, and that is what one of the important goals was. We obviously wanted a system that had really good delivery metrics, so 100% is what we targeted. Obviously, with mobile phones being in picture, we wanted a system that should be that should have a low footprint on battery and data. So that is kind of the problem statement that we wanted to power. And if you could look at the diagram on the right, the blue system is what we wanted to power. We had an HTTP communication channel with our client apps, but we wanted a push-based channel, and that is what we wanted to power. Cool. Before I start going into the depth, I would like to talk about these jargons that I'm going to talk in the talk, so that all of us are on the same page. So I'm going to quickly cover some of these. So Pubsub, Pubsub, as the name explains, it is just a messaging pattern where one user subscribes to a topic and one user publishes to a topic, and that is how the communication is done. So I am listening to a topic. Anybody in the world who publishes that topic, I will receive the message. That is what PubSub really means. Connection is self-explanatory. Topic is basically a string, a UTF string, where you could say that I am listening to this topic. And a subscription is the act of subscribing to a topic. That is all there is. Connect latency is the latency that it takes for a client to connect to the broker successfully. Pub to sub latency is, so for example, if I'm a publisher, the moment I publish a message, and the time it takes for that message to be successfully delivered to all the clients, average of that is what PubSub latency basically denotes here. EMQ is the application that implements the protocol and is the application that we really use to power PubSub. Cluster and bridge, I'll talk about it later when in context. AWS load balancer. So I'm not sure if all of us here are aware of all the services that AWS offers in terms of load balancers, but AWS ELB or classic ELB is one of the load balancing service that AWS offers. And ELB has two metrics. One is surge queue length and one is spillover count. So I'm going to talk about it right now so that whenever I'm going to tell you the context, it's easy for all of you. So surge queue length is nothing but a queue of 1024. So if let's say your load balancer is getting 10,000 requests per second, it will try to make sure that it can serve all of the requests as soon as they come. But in case the backend is not responding instantaneously, or there is a delay in the backend response, so the load balancer, what it does is it starts queuing up these requests, and it queues up to 1024, and that is the limit. Beyond that, any request that comes that it cannot process just goes to spillover count, which is like it will drop that request or it will reject that request. So these are the two metrics. AWS NLB is a new service that AWS has come up with. It's called a network load balancer, and it is catered towards load balancing TCP connections in general, not HTTP connections. So it is, in a way, if you say, it is built for something like PubSub, which has TCP connection and not HTTP connection. Yeah, cool. So if anybody has a doubt in this, please ask right now so that we don't get stuck later. Otherwise, I'll move on. Cool. So this is how it starts, right? What we thought was we want to deliver a system in, we started in September and we wanted to deliver something in March. So we had like a long runway. So we decided, how do we know the system we're going to build is going to be successful or not, right? What does success mean for us, right? And that is what we defined here. So MQTT is a protocol that implements or, that defines PubSub messaging pattern. And EMQ that I talked about is the application that implements MQTT protocol. You can read about MQTT protocol if you want more. I'm not sure if depth of MQTT is relevant for the talk or not. So we chose MQTT as a protocol. There are other protocols as well for PubSub. So for example, Redis implements its own PubSub. Kafka has its own PubSub. So a lot of PubSub solutions are available out there. The language we chose for the application was Erlang, and the choice was something that came from one of my peers in the team, is because that Erlang is a language that is built for distributed fault tolerant systems, and it is really it is really a language that is built for scale. So if you have a service that's going to scale in production to huge peak numbers, something like 25 million, 50 million, so Erlang is a really good language to choose, and that is what we went ahead with. So EMQ was a combination which implemented MQTT as a protocol in Erlang as a language of choice, right? So those are the two decisions that we took. And then we defined that, you know, I should have a system where I should not see connection drop. So if a connection connects, the broker should not drop the connection. The network could drop it, but the broker should not, right? The system should be low connection latency. The client should not wait for, let's say, 10 seconds for the connection to succeed, right? Because if it wait for 10 seconds, we have lost that window, right? So we wanted low connection latency. We wanted low pubsub latency, that is, you know, the heart of the system. So if I have to deliver a message, and if it takes, let's say, 5 seconds to deliver, by the time that message is delivered, the ball has been bowled, you know, the context has gone. So that does not really make sense. So what we thought was, let's have a system which is sub-second at least, if not lesser, right? So we also wanted no subscription drops. I think this is, similar to what connection drops meant. And obviously we wanted a system which can be at least 99% successful, if not 100%. So we wanted a system where message delivery was not the problem. And you know, message delivery, there is a lot of data throughput on the system. So if I have to deliver one message in real time every second, that means 25 million RPS for 25 million clients. And that means 50 million RPS for the system for 50 million clients. So the data throughput was really high. So we wanted the message delivery to be good enough. Cool. Okay. I would also like to talk about one thing before I start is the takeaways, right? So by the time you get up, what I want to communicate to you is that building an application at scale is so much more than just code, right? So if you could just code an application and if that were it, people like us wouldn't really exist, right? So it takes a lot for us to say that the code is ready, my service is feature complete, but now will it work in production or not, and will it work successfully or not? It takes a long way. So I'm going to talk about that journey that we took, because the application really is something that we took, which was an open source application. So what we had was a ready code that worked, but it did not work for scale, and that is what we made it do, right? So that is kind of the core takeaway from the talk. And I'm going to start, you know, this is where the meat of the talk is, where we wanted to get to IPL. We had, like, from September till March, we had a long runway. What we decided was, can we break down the entire journey into, like, checkpoints? And that was really important because we wanted to deliver these features in IPL. There was marketing communication that had already went out, so we couldn't really back off later, right? And this is a system that, you know, you won't really find solutions out there for HTTP, you know, for simple services or for, you know, CRMs or all these things. You will have solutions out there, but for PubSub at scale, you don't really have a solution at scale. So we had to make it either way, right? We had no choice. So what we thought was, can we build in contingencies? Can we set up checkpoints? You know, can we decide so that we make the delivery any way possible? And that is why we decided, you know, we'll set up milestones and checkpoints. Out of those, four were very critical, and those four are what I'm going to cover today. The first one is, we had an open source application which said that it works for 100,000 users at scale. That is the limit they called out, right? So our scale started from millions, so 100,000 was nowhere in picture. So what we said was, can we take this open source application which says it supports 100,000 connections, can we scale it to 50 million or not? So we broke it down into smaller things, and what we said was, let me not think about 50 million, let me think about one instance. Can I exhaust that instance with this application or not? So we thought, let's put 250K as the number, and let's just go and test it and see how it goes, right? So that is basically the first milestone that we targeted for. So our goal was very simple. We wanted to maximize the number of connections on that single node, and that is it, right? And the infra we chose, you know, you can understand it here. I'm not sure if you can see it or not, but we had a C5 4X large instance on AWS, which was our infrastructure of PubSub, and we had a worker infrastructure which had somewhere around 10 M4 XLarge nodes. And there are certain kernel tunings which are, you know, standard for you to exhaust the network and you know, the resources in the system. So we had all of the nodes tuned, particularly. You can obviously find these details over the net, or we have a blog as well where you can find the system tuning details. But assume all of these were tuned to, you know, leverage the best of the resources, and this is how the infra looked like. So what we would do is, we would generate traffic from these worker nodes to the PubSub infra, and the traffic you could assume as being exactly the same as I would do on my app. So I would open my app, I would try to make a connection, and I would try to subscribe to a topic, and that the same thing will be done by the worker infra. if I were to comment, that would be same as sending a message. Or if I were to look at the feed where I am receiving messages, it's also like, you know, I am subscribed to a topic and the broker is sending me messages and I'm receiving those messages. So that is what the worker infra was trying to simulate, basically. Cool. Okay, so before we go on to the results particularly, let me talk about how our scenario looks. So if you could look at the left graph, our scenario was very simple. We would have a simple ramp up of connections. From zero, we will go to, let's say, 250,000 connections. We will hold it for a while, so that the system is stabilized. And then somewhere around here, we would start publishing messages. So there will be one backend service which is responsible for sending messages, and it would send one message, to all the clients who are subscribed. That was the scenario basically. And we would stop the message delivery somewhere around here and then do a ramp down. So that was a simple scenario that we went with. We wanted to test the happy case first, right? The rate at which we were testing was 36 RPS. We calculated the number of messages it is okay for a user to see and read would not go beyond 36 RPS. So that is where we put the limit at. In fact, it is way low, but we wanted to exhaust the system. So 36K RPS is what we really tested. And so this is how a test went. So we would ramp up, we would wait for a while, we would start publishing messages at 36K RPS, and we would see how the latency looked like, right? And once our test, once we had done these publishing messages over a period of time, we would stop that publishing and then ramp down. So this is how the curve looked like. It's difficult for you guys to see, but it says 250K here. So that really shows that, our system was able to scale to 250,000 connections and hold it there. So in terms of connections, there were no connection drops, which was the first success criteria, right? The second curve, if you look over to the right, it kind of shows you the pub to sub latency, and the numbers on the left y-axis are in microseconds. So the 200K or 1 million that you see, 1 million is 1 second basically, and 200K is 200 milliseconds. So what we really went for is, can I get a system that has constant pub to sub latency? Because if the latency is constant, the system can be performant in production. And if this latency was linearly increasing, there would come a time when it would crash eventually, right? So, or the message delivery will be bad, right? So we really went for a constant latency. And this kind of shows you, min, average, 95th, and max are all constant. So which is what we really were aiming for. And that kind of really tells you that, our test was successful and 250K really passed for us. So this is a service, this is an application which the developers say that it is capable of handling 100,000 connections. We've scaled it to 250,000 connections on one node. So that is where we were. And that is what told us that the first milestone is kind of successful. Cool. I will go on to the next milestone. So, so that we're all on the same page. We have an application which is now running in one node for 250,000 connections. If I were to, let's say, deliver 50 million connections, the worst case we had thought of is, okay, we will have as many nodes needed to power 50 million connections. We will make sure the clients are partitioned in a way that certain clients only connect to one node and certain clients only connect to the second one and so on and so forth, right? We could have done that easily, the partitioning of users to brokers. So this is the first time we realize, okay, we can deliver it in production in IPL. So we really had a solution that we could build upon, and that is what the first milestone meant. The second one was, can we now increase it from 250,000 to 2 million, right? So if I could, let's say, do 2 million, I would have 10 of such infras and I could do 20 million and so on and so forth, right? We wanted to build a horizontally scalable system. So that is what the second milestone is about. Cool. So second milestone, what we did was, we said that EMQ has a concept called a cluster. And what that cluster means is that you could group a certain number of nodes together, and those nodes will take care of the intercommunication amongst the cluster. So all you need to do is tell one node that this is the message that needs to be published, and that one node would take care of communicating that message amongst all the other nodes, right? A basic simple rule of how a cluster works. And that is what the infra was. So we chose 5 nodes to start with in a cluster. And again, the worker infra kind of multiplies similar way, and we had 50 nodes. So this didn't really work for us. What we saw was that when we tested the same scenario, the latency kept on increasing as and when we increased the number of nodes in the cluster. So when the number of nodes in the cluster were 2 versus when the number of nodes in the cluster were 5, the latency was very different, right? So And we realize, you know, this can't work because if I increase, let's say, my cluster size to 20, it won't scale as good, right? So what we wanted to really identify is where the issue is. Okay, so I'm going to tell you an anecdote, right? Hotstar live streams GOT. It telecasts it at the same time in US as in US. So I really had the advantage to watch it firsthand, and we would watch it at 6 a.m. when it is telecasted. And I'm an evil person, sorry for that, but I go and share spoilers with my friends, right? So that is what I did. In a WhatsApp group, I shared a spoiler, and now everybody knows what's going to happen in the next episode, which they haven't watched. So they're like, we're going to do the same to our friends. So they did the same to their friends. So they send their messages into their respective WhatsApp groups, right? And that is really what defines what the issue we saw with the cluster, right? And I'm going to explain you how. So just imagine, that a comment instead of spoiler, a PubSub node or a cluster instead of that WhatsApp group, and the respective friend WhatsApp group to be the clients who are connected. So that was the same, you know, that is the analogy here, right? So what we realized is that when we made a cluster, the number of hops increased. If I send it to one node, that one node is responsible to send that message to four other nodes, right? And then those four other nodes, or then those five nodes, would send it to their respective clients, and there is an additional hop, right? So if I were to increase the number of nodes from 5 to, let's say, 10, there are 5 more actions that one node needs to take, right? And that is what really was the reason for linearly increasing latency, right? And you know, we thought about how can we solve it. So if you think about, let's say, if you think about this node here, right? So this node is responsible for doing two things. One is taking a message, transmitting it amongst the cluster, and then transmitting the same message to its own 250,000 clients who are connected, right? So it is doing two jobs. We thought, can we separate these jobs out, right? Can we bring in a person who is responsible just to talk to the cluster, and can then other nodes talk to their clients? So there is a constant latency, right? And this is what really solved for us. So what we did was we brought a common node that is only responsible for publishing, and you could understand it through this architecture here. So what we said was, backend service only publish to one node. That one node is going to publish to all other subscribe nodes. So the delay in the system, I understand that, you know, by introducing a new node, we said that the delay will be constant amongst all, although it will not be good than, although it will not be better than the last one, right? And that is what made sure that the system does not have a linearly increasing latency, and it will not eventually crash. So that was the idea. If you guys have any doubts, please feel free to ask me. What we wanted was that all of the clients should get the message at least the same time, if not for faster or more real time. And this is what we did. So this does one thing, is that if you increase the number of levels, it won't really have as much impact. And if you increase it horizontally as well, it will not have as much impact, because the published node can handle doing or sending a message to 8 nodes in parallel, right? Because we had a C5-4x large node which has at least 16 cores or more. So it can do 16 actions parallelly. So that published node would just do instant transmission to all the nodes, and then the subscribe node would transmit it to their clients respectively. So this fixed that linearly increasing latency for us, and 2 million tests passed with that. If you were to look at that checkpoint, right? So this is the time when we realized that we can set up a cluster that can power 2 million concurrent connections, and I can send messages to that cluster at 36k RPS. So if Hotstar is going to get 10 million scale, at least I can support 2 million of them. That was the goal that we had. And worst case, we could do partitioning among the clients and have 10 clusters which could handle 20 million scale, right? So that is where that checkpoint was. Cool, third milestone. So we were greedy. We said, let's multiply it more further, right? Can we go to 2, 4, 6, 8 million and further, right? And this is not with having a parallel infrastructure. This is having an infrastructure that can support 8 million together, right? And okay, so this is, load balance is something that has given me a lot of sleepless nights. This is an issue that it took a lot of time for us to solve. And I am sure all of you understand why we really needed a load balancer. There were two reasons. One was that client would always connect to a single URL, right? Client cannot say that I will connect to this node's IP or that node's IP, right? It is very difficult to discover for clients. So clients wanted a single IP, and load balancers as a construct is, you know, that it will be a single point of entry. Also, load balancer in its essence is used to load balance traffic. So imagine a scenario, you know, when the math gets interesting, we send a notification to 150 million users at a time, right? And the conversion rate, even if it is less, it brings in a surge of users, right? And if that surge comes in, every system is supposed to handle that surge, right? And it's a huge surge that comes in. So what we wanted was our one node not to take a hit and the load balancer to balance that load amongst the nodes. So that is where we really needed a load balancer. Cool. So I'm going to talk to you about how the load test performed. So the 2 million tests we performed last time, we did the same test with the load balancer. And the load balancer was it's in default configuration. We did not do anything on it. But it failed miserably. It failed so miserably that 2 million that passed, we could not now go beyond 500K. So it was 1/4 of the performance that we had seen. And this is even at the connection phase. Forget message delivery. It could not even hold that many connections, right? So it was very difficult for us to understand. And this is where the search queue length and the spillover count comes in. So what we realized is if you look at the connection drops, it coincides with the search queue length. You know, if you could look at the blue peaks, that goes up to 1024, and the spillover count shows, you know, goes up to millions. So all of our connections that we were trying to connect were not being served by the load balancer, and it said that I cannot take more than 1024, and after that it would just drop all of them. So that is the reason why our connections got dropped, right? And we talked to a bunch of people. I was not a load balancer expert, nor was I a backend expert. I was a backend developer in making. So we talked to a bunch of people, we talked to AWS experts in our company, we talked to AWS outside, and everybody used to say this word, have you gotten your ELB pre-warmed or not, right? So pre-warming is something, I'm not sure if everyone of you knows or not, but AWS says that our load balancers can auto-scale, but it cannot handle surges in traffic. So that scaling takes time. It will take, let's say, a minute or 5 minutes for the load balancer to scale. So if let's say you get a million users in 1 second, it cannot handle it. For it to handle, you tell AWS through a support ticket that, you know, this is the scale that I'm going to expect and this is the peaks I'm going to expect. Can you pre-warm it? So it is like, you know, they keep it ready to handle that scale, and it's a manual request that happens. It's a support ticket request, and that is what we got done, and that is what kind of solved the issue. So it's a form that you fill, which you submit to AWS, and they say, okay, we will pre-warm it for you in advance for the time you want it for, and then only can your load balancer perform, right? So that is the first issue we saw. Cool. So after getting the ELB pre-warm, we were able to replicate that 2 million result on a load balancer, right? And again, the metrics or the graphs show you the same thing, that connections were able to scale up. If you look at the right side, the last three lines at the bottom most show you min, average and 95th percentile, and the max is what had peaks, but we were not really worried about it, because if the 95th percentile or the 99th percentile is constant for us, it's okay if a few messages got delivered late. And what we attributed that was that curve to was there are some messages that the dashboard or the load testing software itself is taking time to compute. So that could also have been reason, because the data throughput and the peak connections were really high in number, right? Cool. So 2 million connection test passed with the load balancer as well. And this is what the comparison looked like. So the only difference in particular was the max latency, which was not so much a worry for us. Okay. So, yes, please. So there was a bit of difference. I don't know if I can tell you or not. I can definitely tell you the exact number, but we definitely saw that 100 to 200 milliseconds were added by the load balancer, right? So it would directly not be the load balancer as the reason, because if you could imagine a system where you're sending 36 RPS messages on, you know, 50 nodes and 5 nodes on one side, the load testing tool itself needs time to compute all of those metrics in real time. So there was some delay that also added. So it was difficult to attribute what was that delay, but there was a delta obviously in terms of the latency. if you see the, I've written the average latency. So without the load balancer, average latency was 500 milliseconds. With the load balancer, average latency went up to 1 second. But again, we were not worried because we had constant latency. So even if one of our success criteria, which was having one sub-second latency, did not go through, we will at least be able to do the other ones, right? Cool. Okay, so this is the second issue that we saw with load balancer, and this was even more painful. So what we said was, we are able to do 2 million on a load balancer. Can I do, let's say, 4 million? Can I do, let's say, 6 million on a load balancer? And we ran that test, and it failed miserably. So even after getting the ELB pre-warmed for 8 million, it could still not perform at 4 million, right? So we were really scratching our heads at what do we do now, right? There is nothing that AWS can offer to us. There is nothing that, you know, we could do on the load balancer. We could not have our own load balancer spin up because that's risky for Hotstar's production scale. So we tried for alternatives. I told you about Hotstar, AWS's NLB. So NLB is really catered to power such kind of a system. They say it is built for TCP connections at scale. Even that could not perform. So this is the 6 million test with one ELB. It was pathetic. So the moment we started sending out the messages, the system would just crash eventually, right? And this is the second curve which we tested with a network load balancer. And forget message delivery, it could even not hold 2 million connections. So it was pathetically bad. It was so bad that AWS, and I don't want to put them in a bad light, but that is a true issue, open on them, and it has taken them a year for them to be able to solve for this particular use case. And I know the use case is very, you know, it's stringent, it has high data and network throughput, but it is not able to handle at least our scenario, the network load balancer. We also tried our own hosted versions of Nginx. We tried Nginx Plus, we tried HAProxy, nothing worked. In fact, it was so bad that one of my broker node could handle more connections than the load balancer itself. So I couldn't really have more load balancers than my nodes, right? So that is out of the picture anyway. There is also a concept called direct server return load balancing. So if you guys want, you can read about it. But what it means is that while I'm trying to connect to the broker, it goes through the load balancer. And the moment data transmission starts, it bypasses the load balancer. So the load, the stress on load balancer kind of reduces. We did not find a hosted solution for that kind of technique, so we could not go with it. And at the end, you know, we scratched our head and we said, okay, one load balancer works. Why don't we multiply that number of load balancers? So we had sharded classic load balancing as the solution. So imagine the infra which I'm going to show in the next slide as well. We had our broker nodes and we had sharded load balancers, something like 6 load balancers in front, all pre-warmed to handle 2 to 4 million connections. So if one could handle 4 million, 6 could handle 24 million, and that is what we really did, right? It was not the best solution, we didn't really like it, but that is all that worked, so we went with it. And it's... Yes, yes. So let me go to the next slide and I'll explain, you know, how that kind of worked. So this is the test result, and 8 million did pass. The only problem was the 99th percentile was now increasing. But we said that is the best we could do. You know, that is the best that is out there. And 95th percentile was a constant curve, so we were not as much worried. If we are not able to do 99th percentile, we are able to do 95th percentile successfully, and that is what we went with. And definitely the latency increased. So the latency is not just a metric of the load balancer or, you know, the hops. It is also a metric of how much stress are you giving that system or how much stress you are putting that system is in, and that is what we saw as well. I know that number seems high, but again, we were not worried because we could not really trust that number. The load testing infra could even be taking that much time, right? So what we wanted was, first, let's get a solution that has constant latency, and then we'll worry about the latency. Cool. So 8 million tests did pass with the load balancer, but we had a sharded load balancing setup, which were all pre-warmed, right? I'm going to show you the architecture in the next slide, and then we're going to talk about why, how we solved the other thing. So this is the fourth milestone. Just so everyone is on the same page, we have now built a system which can handle 8 million concurrent connections at scale. We can send the number of messages we want, which is 36k RPS. Hotstar, prior to us building this, had seen 10 million as peak connections. So we were not far off. If we had tested, let's say 10 million, we could say that, you know, we would be able to handle Hotstar scale. And what we also realized was this system is in some ways horizontally scalable, right? If I were to just keep multiplying the number of clusters, and if I were to just keep multiplying the number of load balancers, I could reach there. The only problem would then become would be AWS saying we don't have resources, right? Or we don't have nodes for you to run on. And we were like, that would not be a problem. And that is why we said that the 8 million system can now handle 10 million and even more, and let's say why not 50 million, right? We had a horizontally scalable solution. And that is where the fourth milestone comes in, where even if we had a system, there was a problem that we could not dynamically scale it. And if we could not dynamically scale it, it would amount to a lot of costs. The step size of scaling would be very, very high. And once scaled up, it can't be scaled down till everybody goes home, right? So that was really the question. And yeah, so this is how the architecture now looked like. We had a published node, we had subscribe nodes, we had sharded load balancing setup. And how this worked for clients is that we added a Route 53 load balancing in front. So there's a domain on Route 53. We use Route 53's DNS load balancing to load balance amongst the load balancers. It is not said to be perfect, but in our production, what we've seen is it works. It kind of equally distributes the load amongst the load balancers. So we did not really have to put another one in front. But so that really worked, and that is how we went with it. So clients still have a single URL. For load balancers, we have sharded load balancers. And that is kind of how the architecture now looks like, which could handle 50 million connections at scale, right? Cool. So I've highlighted this EMQ bridge here, right? So, and I did not talk about EMQ bridge before. So between the publish and the subscribe node, so the scenario looks like this, right? I will send a message to publish node. Publish node is supposed to send a message to subscribe node, right? And there is a concept called EMQ bridge. What it says is that it's like a simple bridge. Every message that gets received at publish node will directly flow through to the subscribe nodes. So if I were to set up, let's say, 4 bridges and send a message to publish node, it would automatically flow over to all the subscribe nodes. And that is how our system kind of works, right? And what we realized was that this is the reason that is not letting us dynamically auto-scale it. And I'll explain you why. So how EMQ bridge works is that it is supposed to be set up from the originator or the source node, and it needs to know about the destination node's IP in advance, right? And that is where the problem was, that if I, let's say, were to scale this infra, what I would do is currently I would scale all the subscribe nodes, get a list of IPs of all the subscribe nodes, send this list of IP to the published node would set up bridges for all the subscribe nodes, and that is how my infra would scale up. Right, and the problem with this was, let's say I want to handle 20 million connections, I would need somewhere around 100 nodes. I could not scale up 100 nodes before the match starts. Right, we see the traffic starts rising slowly from 100,000 to 200,000 to 2 million to 5 million, and there comes a peak which is at 15 million. But that peak does not hold for, let's say, an hour. It holds for 10 minutes, 20 minutes when the match is really interesting. So it was kind of a mountain kind of a curve, and we could not have scaled for the tip of the mountain before the match starts, right? And it was not cost efficient. And what if a subscribe node goes down? I cannot even bring it back up, right? Because I have to bring down the published node, and that is how it could scale up, right? If you guys know, this is a classical service discovery kind of a problem. And there are a lot of solutions available out there, like Console, Zookeeper, which do this service discovery, right? All I need to tell the published node is, hey, I am a new subscriber node, and this is my IP, right? That is all there is to that, right? So a service discovery mechanism like Console or Zookeeper could have solved it, but we wanted a solution that could be simpler, right? Console or Zookeeper would be another system. We would need to set up watchers for everything, and you know, it's another dependency that we had, and that is how we came up with an engineer solution here. So actually, I'll talk about it in the slide only. So if you look at the arrow, right, the connection for a bridge works from a published to a subscribe node, right? And that is where the problem arises. We thought, can we reverse it, right? If you were to just reverse this connection, published node is only single, and I can tell that node's IP or even set it as an elastic IP and tell it to everyone in advance, right? It could even be a domain name for that matter, right? And if the system could be, or if the bridge could be reversed, my system can then dynamically auto-scale, right? I could start with, let's say, only one instance, The moment the second instance comes up, it knows that this is a published node's IP or domain. Let me set up a reverse bridge to that particular published node, and that is it. The moment I set up that bridge, I will start receiving the inflow of messages, right? So that is what we came up with. So we set up a new service called reverse bridge, and what this reverse bridge does is it leverages the MQTT connection in the first place. The connection that the protocol that the entire infra uses, we leverage the same thing to power the same infra. So what we did in the reverse bridge was, reverse bridge is nothing but a simple Golang service. What it would run in the same node as a subscriber node. It would make an MQTT connection to the published node. It would make a subscription to the published node for all topics. It would listen to everything, right? So if a message is sent onto a published node, this MQTT connection and subscription would make sure the subscribe node also receives it. And that is where the beauty came in, right? So it was a very simple service. It is, I think it spans across two or three files. It took us a day or two to get it up. We could just now auto scale the entire infra. So we could start with one node. We could go on till 1,000 nodes for that matter, right? And the image of that subscribe node or the AMI or the Docker image, right, had it inbuilt that it will run two services now. One is the EMQ application and another is the reverse bridge application. Cool. So guess what? 24 million passed. We did test 24 million concurrent connections with this infrastructure in one of our game day scenario tests. So, and this is in January. So we were to go live in March. Hotstar had seen 10 million connections. In our scenario where we replicate and simulate the production traffic, we were able to do 24 million on this infrastructure, right? And I had not seen that many zeros before in life. So that was really good for us. Cool. So, you can obviously imagine by the number of rockets I put in. So this is the impact that we had by this infrastructure. These are some numbers for you to crunch. We ended up sending more than 250 billion messages by this service throughout the IPL, which is 45-day tournament. From the moment it went live in January till now, we have sent over more than 700 billion messages. And by the time you've read this live, the number has increased. Right? So we've powered some really good use cases. And I would say that we've not even exhausted 25% of the entire infrastructure right now. So it's an open call for the entirety of Hotstar. Whoever wants to have a real-time messaging delivery infrastructure use case, please go and use Pubsub. It is set up with simple APIs that you can easily integrate, both HTTP, both MQTT. It's really like a SaaS solution where you can use to send messages to the clients in real time. We've thought about why can't we send personalized recommendations in real time, right? We've thought about can we do configuration updates in real time, right? So there are a lot of use cases that we've thought about. We are already covering a lot many use cases. We are in the prospect of covering more and more. And I go and attend conferences while my infra works and does the job for me. So it was active yesterday. It saw 7 million peak connections. It is going to be active tomorrow in the match. If any of you want to experience, just open Hotstar's app and watch a cricket match, and you will see half of the screen showing you the experience that I showed in the video, right? So that is really the impact that we've had. That is it for me. Thank you so much for attending. These are the ways you can reach me. And we've written an in-depth blog about the entire thing, which talks about the technicalities, shares the tuning details, shares the application, shares how we've really built this structure. You can go and read about it. We've also talked about how the product is and how the design is. So you can also go and read about it. The metrics that you find, the metrics that I've added here are also in a watch report that Hotstar just recently published. So you can also go and refer to that. How I like to end the slide is by this. So the four milestones are the four milestones, but that does not really tell the whole picture. This is how we started in September, and our excitement kind of just grew, and it has been growing ever since. So this is really what the beauty of the system that we built up, and that is it for me. If you guys have any questions, please feel free to ask. Yeah.
So in your system, you had a single published node, right? Wasn't that a single point of failure for your system?
True, that is correct. That is a single point of failure. It has never failed though till now. So, and that does not really answer your question. We could have always went and added more nodes. You could say that it did not give me as much worry to go and do it, but I could do it anytime. So all I needed was for my backend services to be easily to understand which like publish node to publish to, and each publish node would be then connected to each subscriber. So the number of bridges would double, right? I could have done it, we just didn't do it. Like I don't really have a good reason for you to.
What would have happened if say the publish node?
Oh, the entire infra would be down.
Right.
Yeah, I know. As in, yeah. I don't deny it. And you know, while we've solved for so many things, I won't really say we've solved for everything. So there is still things in the system that are loopholes, and again, we could go and fix it. We do have like a auto recovery by ASG and other means. So if it goes down, it will come back up, right? And that node is already known in advance with an elastic IP. So all I need is the time it goes down and time it comes up. That would be a downtime.
Maybe there will be a backup of messages in your system.
Oh, it's not. So it is not like WhatsApp right now. So if you lose messages, it's okay for the product. The moment we go and solve for, let's say, you know, we want history or we want persistence, we could add that in the MQTT by construct supports persistence. So we didn't really have that use case, so we didn't really worry about it as much.
Okay. Can we do a simple, like, how do you scale your subscribers? So if client MQTT will be connected to a ELB, right, using a TCP connection. And this TCP connection with the backend subscribers would be again a persistent connection.
Correct.
And so
our load balancer has double the amount of connections our system can support.
Okay. But if you add one new subscriber, you're not ensuring that all the new connections are going to that new free server at that particular moment.
Okay,
so how do you manage that?
Got
like adding new machines into the system.
Right. So it would have been perfect if, you know, every new incoming connection went to, let's say, a node that has least number of connections. And there is a strategy for that. So there, not for TCP, but I know there's a strategy where load balancer can do least, you know, the send traffic to the node that has the least amount of traffic. But the problem there was, let's say I get a surge, right? And one node I just scaled up has zero connections, right? I can't send all 250,000 connections to one node, because if it, let's say, take 100 milliseconds for one connection to go through, some would have to wait eventually, right? So what we wanted was, I should not like open the floodgates to one node. I should slowly send traffic to all the nodes. And that is why we use round robin load balancing algorithm. And what round robin gave us was that it would make sure the load is first distributed amongst all, right? And that is where the second problem comes in. I'm sorry, I could not have talked about it, but we did solve for that. So the second thing we solved for, that one node cannot handle more than 250,000 connections, right? But that does not mean it cannot connect. It will be able to connect. It will just make the performance of the entire infra bad, right? So, and that is a problem for us, right? One incoming connection could just fuck up the 250,000 connections that are already existing and working. So what we said was, MQTT application has a configuration where it says, this is the limit of connections I can handle. That is one thing we did. Second thing is, we limited the number of file descriptors and TCP sockets we could use. So that also limited the connection. So if it wants to, it cannot go beyond. And what it could go to is something that it can scale to, right? So load balancer would try to send in the connection to that node. It will say, I cannot handle more, and it will reject it, right? That was the first phase we came to. And there is another strategy we used, where we had a different health ELB and different traffic ELB. So we made sure if a node comes and gets full up to the brim, it is removed from the load balancer, right? And when I say it is removed from the load balancer, the connections still persist, but it is not in the pool to be able to receive more connections. Did I explain that?
But
I can repeat it if you want.
Yeah, but does ELB support that? I mean,
so ELB itself does not support it, but when we talked to AWS team, we came up with, you can call it a hack. We came up with, you know, a traffic ELB and a health ELB, two ELBs. My clients only know traffic ELBs, but my health ELB is one responsible for managing the number of instances that are spun up, right? And who is connected to or not, right? So the moment a node gets up to the brim, I will remove it from the traffic ELB, but it's still healthy, right? And the connections are successful, the messages would go through. The moment it comes down from the brim, I would connect it back to the health ELB, to the traffic ELB. So it's kind of a hack, but AWS team kind of prescribed it to us. We didn't really have any other solution, by the way. So that was the only solution.
Thank you.
Any other question? Yeah, please.
So you've explained the subscriber side of things, but the publisher needs to have to be able to handle the 2 million connections as well, right?
No, right. So at least not in many at least not in our use case. I'll explain you why. So this one. So publish, what we said was we really wanted to solve broadcast as a use case, right? So there is one backend service which knows this comment is really good, right? And I want to send this comment over to all the clients, right? So there's only one publisher, right? That one publisher publishes a published node, which is again single. The published node is responsible for transmitting that message onto, let's say, 100 running subscriber nodes. So 100 actions in parallel, right? And then subscriber node has the traffic to send it to all the clients. So I don't really see how you're trying to say that published node could become the bottleneck, or it needs to handle connections at scale. It does not need to, right?
The published node is not actually connecting to the client.
No, it is not. So PubSub as a construct says, you know, anyone can transmit to anyone, but we said that broadcast use case does not need that. So for us to be able to solve broadcast use case, when you send a comment or when you comment something, that does not directly go to me, right? It has to go through a moderation. It is for now a one-to-many and one-to-one. So we solved broadcast and unicast, not something like a WhatsApp. It's not like a group you can talk amongst yourself right now. And obviously, you know, you understand because I need to vet the message before I send it to the client, right?
Any questions?
Okay. Okay, so how we came up with that number is we it was not the first number that we came up with, by the way. We started with, like, you know, 5,000, 10,000. We eventually came up to a point where we said one node can handle 500,000 connections. But when we started sending messages, the message delivery was not good and the latency was bad. So we came down from 500K and 250K was the one which was performant. And that is how we said to. Sorry? Oh, yeah. So again, first milestone is not the first checkpoint. It is something that we decided that works, but we came up to that number and not, like, yeah.
Hi, how did you train the auto, the comment moderation models, and what latency did it add, and especially like with the Indian lingo and the context and all that stuff?
So we should give another talk on that. It's like a detailed, it's like a mammoth on its own, but it, you know, if I could just quote rough numbers and not, don't hold me to it, it added somewhere around 2 to 5 seconds of latency. We have some ML algorithms that, you know, with a trained data set which tells you whether a comment is profane or not. That is the first bar we wanted, you know. And then we have a set of manual moderation which, you know, manual moderators are sent highlighted comments, or, you know, comments with more confidence in terms of profanity, comments with more confidence in terms of relevancy. We had a huge list of sports terminologies, team names, cricketer names, and stuff like that. So we would always rank those messages higher, and then a manual moderator would say whether it is good enough for the message to go out or not.
Was it completely English based, or did it
So I can't really stop the user from typing Hindi. Right? Like, yeah. There are keyboards that let you type Hindi even if you don't allow it from your keyboard. What we could have done is, you know, gave out an error, but that is what we really did not want to do. What we had done was we could identify Unicode characters and say that whether it's in English or not. And till the time we had not solved for the other languages, we were not allowing Hindi. But if I'm not wrong, I think we have a fair amount of confidence on Hindi as well. And with manual moderation, we allow some of it to pass. But it's still a challenge. Like, it's not easy. In fact, Hindi is still easy. Like, solving for local languages is very difficult. Like, you don't really have a vocabulary easily available, or, you know, trained data set easily available. So it's difficult.
So I don't know about your application architecture, but I was just wondering, couldn't a topic tree hierarchy of the MQTT be used in a way to isolate the clusters a bit more?
So that would really mean going and changing the application. And obviously it's possible. I won't say it's not possible, I'm not sure what advantage would that give us. Like, as in, have you thought of one advantage?
In the sense that you're dependent completely on ELB and ELB for the financing.
Right. Got it.
But you could use the topic tree hierarchy also to actually isolate it on that level.
Got it. But I would still need a URL to connect to, right? So let's say the nodes could handle amongst themselves that these topics, this bunch of nodes will only handle.
Yeah, so I think EMQQ has a try kind of routing based on the topic.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
I think the EMQ has a try kind of routing based on the topic error.
I think I've read about it. I've not really tried it. Maybe that could have been a solution. But this, so my bet is on network load balancer. Since network load balancer is one that is supposed to handle TCP connections and it auto scales as well. I don't need any pre-warming requests at all. There is a service that is, you know, what AWS builds and is production ready, has support. So I would much rather go and, you know, use a hosted solution than really build our own. But if let's say the ELB would not have worked, we would have gone and, you know, changed the EMQ application. We did go and look at Erlang code, by the way. I have my peer who did really go and solve that issue here. You know, we could have gone and solved probably this as well, but we never really felt the need. Anything else?
Thank you.
Cool,
thank you so much, Piyush.